very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the very first Ranbir Singh Memorial Lecture. I'm your host, Arya Khan. And with me, I have someone very special here today, the man who headed the armed forces in India, and yes, the nephew of Bhagat Singh, ladies and gentlemen, Paramveer Chakra. With us, we have General Sheonan. Very good evening, sir.
So first things first, that I'm very excited about. How does it feel like being the bloodline of Shaheed Bhagat Singh?
To me, it's an accident of birth. But yes, I had to hide my ancestors and also the fact that I was related to the family during my service. Right. Because I didn't want to be answering questions about Bhagat Singh while serving myself.
Right.
But it's a great honor to be respected and given time by people. And the relation for me is knowing Bhagat Singh, knowing the way he thought,
right,
living his thought. That is when you are relative. Otherwise, you are just accidentally born in the family.
That's
and
right.
You are not a relative.
Right.
Well, we are glad that you are definitely not accidental, sir. So there is one question that I had in my heart, and I think everyone thinks about it, is what does the word freedom mean to India today? Today is India.
No, freedom always means one thing. That is, individuals should be able to live without being exploited.
Right.
So, if we feel that today is India, there are people who are not exploited, we are free. But I feel differently. Because after 70, 80, 75 years of system, whatever system we created after the Britishers left, we haven't been able to reach even the semblance of a stage where we can say that people are not exploited. I mean, man is not being exploited by man.
Right.
Man is not being exploited by system. 60 to 70% of our population, which is basically agro-based, is
right,
being exploited. I'm not even talking about the sweepers and other people who are working in the category 4, 5, etc.
Right.
Where they are today, even the graduates are coolies. On railway station, they're actually coolies, postgraduates.
Wow.
So aren't they being exploited? Isn't that man being exploited only because he's poor or only because he has disadvantages at the time of his birth? So if the system have not developed to do something or anything for these people, then there is a need to revolution. Revolution, I mean an idea, the acceptance of which will change the system. I'm not saying that we need to fight with guns and weapons. We need to have an idea which will change the way we function, the way the nation is laid out today, the way the governments are functioning. Whether you get this one or that one, it doesn't really make a difference.
Right.
These people have failed or deliberately not done it, where you can provide an environment where a man doesn't have to be dhobi if he doesn't want to be dhobi.
Right.
So this is such a thing that today we all feel that, you know, exploitation is such a huge part, that, as you're saying. And to change this, we have to be the part of the system. But today's youth, as we all have experiences, they are not that patriotic as it was before. They don't want to bring in the change. They don't want to bring the nation. What do we do to ignite that fire in them?
Instead of igniting, we need to put off certain fires.
Right.
Today, every man is carrying one type or the other type of God on leash. So when two people come in contact, the gods will start barking at each other. Those two human beings can't even talk to each other. So unless we do that, we take away this system of religion and God from our thinking and start thinking about man, that it cannot happen. I mean, today, the youth is more worried how is religion. Means today people are finding more cohesiveness,
right,
in being together on a religious function than a function where you are thinking of some betterment for the society.
Right.
It's very difficult to find a place where you can go and speak and you will be heard because you are talking about the good of the men, people, or you are doing something about the good of the people.
True.
So we have to educate people. Education does not mean literacy. Education means the ability to think. A man is called Ashraful Makhlukat because of his ability to think.
Wow.
Today we are killing that man's ability to think because we are tying him down with one type of the God or the other. So unless that happens, we cannot blame the youth. We are deliberately doing it. Our system is paying it out to them. to become religiously compartmentalized and bark at each other.
Wow. Very well said. Well, taking you a little away from this topic, sir, as you all know, when we talk about freedom fighters, two names, the very first two names that come to our minds is Bhagat Singh and Gandhiji. So what is your take on, as we know that they were diametrically opposite in their approach to freedom fighting, what is your take on that?
You know, it's something like potatoes is also vegetable and tomatoes is also vegetable. You can't compare tomatoes and potatoes. But because you have asked this question, and as a thinking individual, I must give you a reasonable reply rather than just giving this vegetable type reply. The question is that Mahatma Gandhi is famously famous for being non-violent. Everybody whosoever talks of Gandhi speaks of non-violence.
Yes.
Now, I would like to question that non-violence, in which more than a million people died fighting for our enemies outside our country in First and Second World Wars.
Right.
And Gandhi was okay with that. Whereas he was not okay with even with two people dying in India and killing five Britishers in India. That was violent. Yes, how can this be that same people, same Indians have gone, got killed in so many numbers and nobody ever remembers them? And here we are talking about non-violence, and another people who said that, okay, let's fight with these people when they are weak. They were weak during First World War. They were weak during Second World War.
Right.
We should have fought here. Half the numbers which died in First World War and Second World War, even less than that, would have got us the independence. So this is the difference. I'm not saying that one should become violent and start doing things, but you should not go to the extent of being such a hypocrite that you're getting your people killed outside and you're still calling yourself non-violent.
So
that is my understanding of non-violence so far as non-violent movement of India is concerned. Now, between the two of them, there were two generations apart.
Right.
One was thinking forward, one was thinking backward. One was taking up to Gita and all those things and backwards movement, instead of taking medicine, put mud paste and things like that. Whereas on the other side, the other person was approaching the political thinking as a science. He was reading about people. He was trying to educate the young people of this country through his letters and essays and other things on the modern thinking, or the thinking which was taking the nations forward. The thinking which had moved or removed imperialism from number of countries.
Right.
He was trying to teach that type of thinking to our people. I don't call him non-violent. He was a person which was possibly far, far ahead of his time. If Adiguru Shankaracharya can be Adiguru at 32 years age, die and still be famous, why can't Bhagat Singh at 23 years of age have understood this part? So let's grant him that ability that he had third dimensional capability to think. Whereas normally we think in two dimensions. He had a different ability, so therefore he could think. And I don't think there is a comparison between the two. We should not even, we are doing injustice to both of the people by comparing them or even trying to compare them.
Well, that's true. And I think that's a beautiful point made, that accepting violence is also violence. So that is definitely a question mark when we say that hum jab violence nahin karte hain, toh kya hum violent hain ya nahin? All right. Coming to our last question, sir, what do you think is going to be for today's youth especially, right? So for example, when we grew up, we had our heroes that we heard stories about, whether it was Gandhiji, whether it was Bhagat Singh, all these people, Sukhdevji, all of these people. But the coming generations, we are talking about probably two decades from now, a decade from now, who are going to be the heroes for them? Because I feel that these heroes are going to be lost somewhere. In today's time, the fight is no more about really picking up guns and shooting people, but it is definitely about, as you said, ki itna zyada hamare yahan par corruption ho gaya hai. To uske liye fight mein kya koi heroes aayenge aage? But what will our coming generation do? What heroes are they going to look up to?
I feel we have reached a stage where the youth doesn't need any hero, doesn't need anything. It means it has reached a stage where the process itself produces heroes.
Right.
It means we have gone so down that we can't go further down. So now we have to only rise. And that need, the hunger, the unfairness of the whole system will bring up those heroes and young ones, hopefully. And they are the ones who will then be remembered for generations to come. And I'm waiting. I'm actually very happy that we have come to this stage in my lifetime, because I will be able to see some movement taking place where some young heroes will come up. And they don't have to look at heroes. They have to look at, they have to study what is happening. They need to educate themselves. They need to educate that why things are the way they are. And they will come up as heroes. They don't have to look at, means today we have our own self-created semi-imperialistic government. So or semi-dynastic government, for whatever you call it. And today, means like in old age, the king used to have a godman standing next to him to support his ideas that, yes, the god also says so. Today, the god is saying everything, the other man is not there. So that other man have to be produced. And this system has created a situation where the generations will throw up that type of man, and I'm hoping that will happen. I mean, I can't put my finger on something that this is how it will happen, but it is going to happen now because we have created enough muck. It has to be clear.
That is true. As General Sheonan says, yes, enough is enough, and I guess we now need to rise to the occasion. We now need to say a no. That is unacceptable for us. And we really hope so. This is not literacy talking, ladies and gentlemen. This is wisdom talking. And we really hope that we are able to walk a little bit, wee bit on that path. Thank you so much, sir. It was indeed a pleasure interviewing you.